Yep, Gary didn't get to go. All right, who's watching what?
I watch it, but I can't see anything.
You can't see. He sees nothing. I see nothing.
Ah, it's there, yeah.
Hey, wait, hey, wait. Here's what we need to know. A report from the YouTube audience. Do you have audio? That's all I care about right now. Actually, I care about more than that. But I want to know.
I don't see anything on YouTube yet.
It's there. And I'm listening. And we have audio. Woo! Yeah, Gary didn't get to go.
All right.
Who's watching?
Yeah, okay. That's the audio. I watch it, but I can't see.
No, don't watch it or see it. I'm just going to pop out the chat, and then we're going to introduce Marshall to these people, and he's going to think, why did I show up for this?
No, I'm going to think, why did you invite me?
David, you know, the subject matter expert. Yeah, actually, if you can play the music, it would be great because I have it here somewhere, but I'm not sure it's set up. The subject matter expert in my mind is the guy that read the manual half an hour before he came to teach you how to do it. And if he knew it even before that, even the better.
David, you got all those little gallery pictures up there.
Oh, where? What are
you talking about? On the broadcast, everyone is seeing tiny little gallery pictures.
Gallery pictures?
From Zoom.
Really?
We see three big pictures and then two little pictures.
What's the two
little pictures? I don't see two little pictures.
I see it. I think that's your helmet, Gary. The Zoom output is the three of you. Nobody wants to see me, for sure. Nobody wants to see me. And if you want to see me, I could add me onto the side over here.
Oh, there you go.
But I think we're going to have...
You should be here.
Now I lost it. Yeah, well, we'll bounce around. We might go this way, too, but this
never mind on the gallery pictures. That was my problem.
Yeah, I kind of figured that part out. So yeah, we're here. Are you ready to start the show? I'm going to try this, and if it doesn't work, then we're going to go to you.
I got to find out where I left my phone because it's ringing.
Oh, Gary's phone's ringing. All right. Are you ready to do this? We are going live. It's 7 o'clock.
Oh, okay. I can play the music.
Yes, play the music, please.
Are you getting the music?
We hear the music.
This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. That's how that works. The fly-in isn't working.
I broke the fly-in. You should just keep going, Gary.
And from the top of King Con Lift in Park City, Utah, where it's getting really warm.
Yep.
Gary Pierce, K4AQ, King of Ham. And I'm supposed to be skiing this week, which is why I'm up here on the ski lift.
All right,
make the ham radio thing go away.
Yeah, I'm not sure I can make it go away. Extra. We'll see. Oh, the both of them. Why is there both of them there?
You're doubling up on the ham radio now.
I am.
So, and it's getting really warm up here.
All right, you should take your helmet off.
It's also
and I'm
bright,
gonna go to me.
Bright and sunny for some strange reason at 8 p.m.
Yep, and I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, from the garage below my parents' house along Mulholland Drive, the base of the Santa Monica Mountains. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and then we'll go to my friend Jim there. Where's Jim?
From the sunny base of Mount M&M in Silicon Valley.
Mount M&M.
Aspinwall, N01 PC.
Mount M&M.
And from Corona, Marshall Oldham, KE6PCV,
California. Look, you know what? I didn't ask you about this ahead of time. I'm not sure what to put on your lower third, but this is what you get, Marshall.
Okay, that looks great.
And I even went to the Wayback Machine to find a CalNet logo because you dropped it off the new website.
Yes.
I could not find it anywhere.
Let's talk to Doug about that.
Yep. It's still up there. It's just not in the foreground.
I looked for a while. I looked for quite a while. Actually, you know what? I think I didn't get to the members login because I've never been official. So... here's Marshall. We're going to talk about what was the show title today? Did we even get to that part?
An All-Star Cast.
And just so you know, Gary, Jim came up with that. I couldn't do it. I reached really hard. Jim, 100%.
Creativity.
It was all Jim.
I'm good for something.
Yep, it was all Jim.
Did you get the episode number right?
I totally did. Look, 460.
I think that's right.
It's right. I know it's right. Because I looked three times.
You got that from the show notes.
It was right. Yeah, and that's true. Jim helped me with the show notes.
That's what I have to do. I have to go look at the YouTube page or the website or something and see what the old one was. And because otherwise I can't tell.
So an All-Star cast that totally isn't me. I think that's Marshall and you guys. Well, Gary, do you All-Star at all? Do you do All-Star at all?
There's a reputed network here, local, well, semi-local, South Carolina, North Carolina, that uses All-Star as its linking system. And you can get into it with All-Star, but I have not done the All-Star part. I just know that that's what they use. And I'm curious what it is.
Me too. And that's why Jim said, let's have a guest. And that guest is Marshall. Thanks for coming, Marshall. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Hey. When did you become a ham? Well, how'd you get here? And
oh, gosh. I've been a ham for over 20 years. Started in the hobby as a...
He thinks that's a long time.
Yeah, I know it's not a long time, but... my joy in the hobby is actually building stuff, building repeaters, tinkering around. I guess you could call me jack of all trades, but master of none. So I like to build. So as a young new ham, got involved with this repeater group, CalNet, and was dumb enough to volunteer to go up on the hilltops and try to fix the repeaters with no experience. So did a lot of looking over shoulders, met a whole bunch of good people in ham radio. And by going on these hilltops, asking a lot of questions and looking over shoulders, slowly learned my way around repeaters and linking repeaters, maintaining repeaters, building repeaters.
Climbing towers,
hanging antennas, building feed lines, programming controllers, converting Motorola mobile radios to repeaters, trying to be kind of cost effective in the hobby, but yet have nice repeaters.
So let's talk a little bit about CalNet. We know Jim's up in the Bay Area, and you said Corona, so you're down here in Southern California. And one would assume CalNet, California probably covers most or a good part of California. What tell us about CalNet.
Well, CalNet it started out as in the early years, the NBC repeater group. And it was basically two repeaters that were linked together here down in Southern California. And the two repeaters grew to three, and three repeaters grew to four or five. And finally, we were linking repeaters from Southern California up to Northern California, the Bay Area. And back then, 20 years ago, that was pretty much a big deal. An RF linked system. We used all radio to do this. And after that, we met a whole bunch of great people. That's where I met Jim. He got involved up in the Bay Area. And our system has grown to about 18 repeaters that are all linked together. Probably in the late 2000s, we started dabbling in voice over IP and linking repeaters via voice over IP on a system called IRLP, which stood for or stands for Internet Radio Linking Project. So we played with that a few years, and there was a VOIP conference in Vegas that was put on by a ham, Kent Johnston, W7AOR. So every year we would go there and meet and talk about the cool things we did with ham radio and voice over IP and linking. And Kent says to me, hey, you need to check out this new system called All-Star. Well, I'm thinking, well, that All-Star, that sounds kind of corny. I wonder what that is. So fast forward 6 months, Kent Johnson, W7AOR, introduces me to Jim Dixon, WB6NIL. And Jim says to me, I want to put an All-Star node on your system because I want to promote All-Star. Now, I had no idea what AllStar was, what it involved, other than it seemed to be a really cool toy to play with. So in 2006, Jim calls me up and says, we'd like to come over to your house and interface AllStar into CalNet. And I'm like, great. So at that time, he was living in San Diego. He came all the way up to Corona, and we interfaced an AllStar system into CalNet. Now, the first problem is my home is a hub. There's no repeater here. And so I'm like, Jim, we need to make this act like a port on the controller. He goes, no problem. So,
you know, I don't want to complain, but I just got lost about 10 minutes ago and I haven't been found yet.
I'm still with you. I'm still with you, but let's slow down for Gary.
It sounds like we came in the middle here somewhere, which I'm famous for doing.
Okay.
Actually let Gary ask you a question so Gary could catch himself up.
Yeah.
Okay.
What part are you working from current knowledge, or have I just not been paying attention?
Are you asking me that question?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm
not in the middle because you know what he's talking about already?
Yeah, kind of.
And because I have no idea.
Well, no, I know what he's talking about.
He's got a house. He's got a port. He doesn't have a repeater. That doesn't make any sense to me. I got lost back at IRLP.
Yeah. And that's actually when I first started looking for stuff about, you know, I look for stuff about our guests so that I can, you know, show the good, the bad, the ugly, and have more information. The first stuff that I found about you, Marshall, was the website, and I think it's dated 2008 or 2009, where you're making IRLP. Are you still making IRLP cables?
I still am to this day.
Do you still sell a lot of them?
I sell a ton of cables. I sell a ton of AllStar cables.
Uh-huh.
I sell a few IRLP cables.
All right, now
nobody knows what an IRLP cable is.
Let's catch Gary up now.
Okay.
Yeah, we can go back to some history, because I think it's fascinating what Jim Dixon created and why he created it when he did. And at that time, there were in the beginning of doing things voice over IP, there were two applications that stood out. One of them is pretty much the ubiquitous Echolink, which people can use from their PCs, and there'll be Echolink connections at on repeaters, so you can dial them up, and if you don't have a radio, you can participate in ham radio remotely over the internet. And then Dave Cameron in Canada came up with IRLP, and still maintains that as a proprietary system of interconnecting repeater nodes. So, you know,
what I remember about IRLP is it doesn't let you get into the network from a computer. You can only get in from a repeater.
Yeah,
right.
Internet.
Unless, of course, you own the repeater, and then, of course, the repeater's got to connect.
Internet linking.
Internet radio linking.
Radio project. Linking project, right? So it's linking internet radios on the internet, Gary. We're going to walk from the front to the back of it.
There you go.
So it's not about your computer. Well, you use the computer to link the radio. But the radio links to the internet.
You do not. You, the user, do not. You use your radio. That's all.
Yes. Yes. But somebody has a
owner.
Yes.
The repeater owner who in the vast scheme of things in ham radio is a faceless, anonymous ghost.
Oh, no, but both of these guys have IRLP nodes.
Yeah,
but you know what? I almost had one in when we had on the Papa system, they would play every day for a number of years ago, the Good Morning with Radio on the IRLP. You guys are aware of that. You knew that, Jim, right? Marshall, you've heard of that before. Do they still do that? Anyways, for a while on the Papa system, they would link into that IRLP node.
Voice.
And in the IRLP mode, they would play this and you could check in. And I could check in and talk to somebody in Canada or on the East Coast or the whatever on our Papa system. Locally, UHF, VHF, the radio.
But you never heard the repeater owner talk.
No, but I did have the option of I could have bought a smaller radio that would have got me from wherever I am locally here, and bought a board and probably ordered cables from Marshall to plug in from between the radio and my computer, so that I could too have been a, I don't know if they call it a hub or an access point or a.
Yeah. So the IRLP system, you can connect to another IRLP node directly, but there are also reflectors that you can configure to be a hub for multiple things you want to connect to. It's not as flexible as there aren't a whole lot of user controls to say, I want my IRLP node to talk to X instead of Y today. You're pretty much, you know, bound in a in a point-to-point or to a reflector system. And
that's very much how D-Star works, right? You say, hey, I want to go to this channel, or I want to go to that channel, or reflector,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, it's sort of a talk group kind of thing, like DMR and the rooms on Fusion and things of that nature.
Right.
So, but that's... it's not an open source situation. You have to use an interface board that that you have to acquire from Dave, because that's what his software talks to. And it runs off a Raspberry Pi. So you've got a Pi commitment. You've got an IRLP interface board commitment.
Got to buy some cables from Marshall.
And radio interconnect cables from Marshall.
And then a radio.
So that's,
and then an antenna and some coax and yeah.
Yeah, that was sort of the start. I mean, you could do some repeater linking with Echolink, but Echolink has been mostly a ham without a radio sitting in a hotel room or in a place you can't use a radio to connect into, you know, a friend's system.
I would say it's both. There's lots of repeaters that have Echolink connections on them.
Right, right.
Right, but you can't pick this up and talk to the Echolink node from driving through the neighborhood or wherever you're.
You could access.
So the Echolink isn't something you talk through a radio. Echolink is an application that you talk on the repeater through the internet. Whereas
your handy talkie to a repeater,
not on
Echolink.
Echolink. There isn't any of this in Echolink.
Yeah, there is.
No.
Your handy talkie talks to a repeater. Repeater's got an Echolink node connected to it. Just because you can do it on your phone doesn't mean you can't do it through a repeater.
But
that's not what he's saying, Gary, and we'd like to try and clarify this. You could build your own Echolink node at home.
Yes.
And it talk to other Echolink nodes, or if you're in range of a repeater that has Echolink, you can talk to that and whoever is connected to the Echolink node. But many of the cases of Echolink use are from a non-radio device dialing into the Echolink node.
Yeah. I think what we're saying is Echolink does many things.
Yeah,
it does more than everything else.
So what about this AllStar thing? No? Okay, sorry.
Okay. Well, it does many things.
Yeah.
It can do two things. It can accept client, non-radio client connections, and it can accept radio-to-radio connections. So which is what you can do with IRLP, though there is no desktop client. So IRLP is limited in bridging only between a junction point. Mm-hmm. Excuse me?
No phone client either.
No phone client.
Yeah.
AllStar is open source, very flexible, multiple ways of access, just like people are doing with DMR hotspots and things of that nature. So where you get into subtle differences is the reliability of what's happening and the flexibility and the audio quality. And that's where Echolink has got some issues, because you don't have control of the codecs that... that translate the audio into digital, so you don't have the control over that. So you end up with whatever Echolink's got built in for audio, analog to digital audio and back and forth. And you don't have any remote control of that. Echolink may be able to ID, but it can't function as a repeater controller. It's not natively designed to do linking. You can't control an Echolink node from the air. It either does or doesn't exist at the whim of whoever implemented it.
So the AllStar system will do that for you?
The AllStar system can act as a repeater. A node can act as a repeater controller. It can act as a remote base. It can act as a link between systems. You can have a radioless AllStar node that you can have a microphone and a speaker connected to it instead of a radio. And you have full DTMF control of who and what you connect to. And you can connect to multiple different systems from the same node.
Is it
a node can act as a hub and accept multiple connections.
Is it Windows?
Which is how we're using it.
Windows PC, Linux, Unix, what's the software that drives it all?
I'm gonna figure out a segue here to Marshall on this. The basis of this, and I'll just give a little history, and Marshall's had the pleasure of meeting Jim Dixon before he passed. Jim Dixon is known as the guy who created voice over IP software while he was working at Nortel, and came up with this ingenious way of getting off of proprietary software for the various Panasonic, Nortel, other telephone business telephone systems, and created a business telephone system, a private branch exchange, if you will, in Linux software. And Nortel said, "Oh, that's a wonderful development. You know, maybe we're going to use this." And he said, "Well, you know, maybe you guys ought to pay for it." And Nortel said, "We're not going to pay for it." And he said, "Okay, basically the legend is I'm going to put you out of business." And in effect, Jim's coming up with Asterisk, which is the core of AllStar. Asterisk is now the core of many, many, many phone switching systems.
Yeah, so phone systems. Asterisk, that's like a open source PBX.
Yes.
Software. Okay. Yes. I haven't used it, but I'm a little familiar with what it is.
So, being a ham, I don't know what gave Jim the inspiration to say, "Hey, let's connect this to a radio." But I'm pretty sure when he started seeing linked radio systems trying to recreate DTMF routing and linking between systems, he said, "Well, I got software that does that. Why don't we just interface my software and some hardware to a radio and see what we can do?" And here we've got, Marshall's the first guinea pig. So of all of us who have dealt with the Cactus Intertie system, WIN system, all the various controllers from RLC and others, Jim found Marshall, and so we CalNet were the one of the first systems to experience the flexibility and quality of AllStar, and that's when. Marshall knows much more about that story up until we really expanded our implementation of it here.
Is AllStar what links all of the, when you said 18 CalNet repeaters together, or there's other linking, there's other backbone stuff as
primarily
well?
Primarily RF. Mm-hmm. And that's the real ham radio of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. I came at this from the Texas Intertie system, which followed very closely and pioneered some things for what is also known as the Cactus system out here in California. Mm-hmm. So I was around with the Cactus Intertie when it tied things into Texas. And so there's that.
You've confused me in saying that you're mostly RF.
Yeah,
AllStar is an RF network system.
So as we built out these linked repeater systems across the state, the back end of the repeater controller has got a linking radio that talks to another link radio on another port of another controller of another repeater system. So it was point-to-point RF linking for most of these linked systems. And due to some site challenges, some RF challenges, I said, "Well, we have to stay connected to Southern California while we figure this out." And with the AllStar presence in Southern California, I said, "Marshall, we got to get hooked up here. I will put I'll put AllStar up here to put us back together." So it was Northern California punching the way through that the RF gap. And said, "We're going to stay connected to Southern California," and we've been that way with AllStar. How many years has it been, Marshall? 5, 6 years that our connection is not completely RF anymore. It's on radio over IP.
So to answer your question, Gary, yes, CalNet does have RF links, but we also have the digital links using AllStar. for some of the paths that we can't do RF linking with.
Okay. And are you using the AllStar software and hardware for controlling the RF linking up in Northern California? Or are you using somebody else's controller?
So the back end of our systems, while Cactus and others had built custom controllers, our base repeater controller at most of the sites is an RLC Linkcom controller.
Okay.
So that handles all the ID, that handles the carrier access, the timing, and we can DTMF control what other radios, or in some cases, if we can have an AllStar node connected as a radio interface into that controller.
So it's it's complex, multi-function and multi-port.
Yes.
No wonder I don't understand.
It does have the capability to be a repeater controller. That too.
That's what's running here. And so I gave up on the RLC controller here at the house just to see how good a repeater controller this is. And so there's a Raspberry Pi and an interface board made by designed by a guy, Kevin Custer of Masters Communications, who builds a lot of interface boards for a lot of repeater and remote base interfaces. So we could segue into what that is, but I'll let Marshall tell the story, and then maybe I'll pull up one of my nodes and show the boards, and we'll describe how you get from a Raspberry Pi and some Linux software into a radio.
All right. So where do you want me to start off, Jim?
Well, Gary got confused about Jim Dixon says let's put Linux on a radio. So if we resolve most of that, then we can go into the architecture of implementing.
Okay. So we'll, again, I met Jim Dixon and Steve Rogers, who basically wrote the software and invented the hardware interface to tie a radio into a VOIP system. So they showed up at my house and installed the AllStar system. And I had a controller at my house because I had several links to link one hilltop to another. The RF links would come down to my house.
So RF links are at your house?
Yes.
Yeah. So there's a bunch of radios, and those are connected to the internet to tie them together?
Yes.
Got it. Okay. So you got a big tower like Jim has then?
No, not a very big tower. No. Just a few small Yagi antennas.
Okay.
On UHF. So anyways, that was the beginning of a friendship between Jim and I. I am not a computer expert by any means. I don't have the background or education, only dabbling in the hobby. So Jim and I became friends through the years after that. When he came and did that, he actually gave me the hardware for free. His own money, and we enjoyed the AllStar system for many, many years. As a matter of fact, the hardware that he installed in my garage back in 2006 is still running in the garage, a testament to his design and the software that they developed, him and Steve Rogers.
Is that the original four-port, the PCI card?
Yes, it is a mini ITX board. For those of you that know about computers, and there's a four port PCI card that's plugged in to the mini ITX board, and the hard drive is actually not a hard drive. It's a compact flash drive, and that boots up and it loads the operating system into RAM, so that once the AllStar computer boots up, there are no moving parts. There's no fan. There's no hard drive, so to speak. Everything is run in RAM. And the design of the system was basically to be very, very dependable, so that you wouldn't, if it was on a hilltop, you wouldn't have a hard drive failure or hard drive crash, because there's really nothing to fail other than maybe the RAM getting maybe glitched and the operating system getting glitched, at which point you just hit the reset button on the computer and you're back up and running because nothing is being written to the compact flash.
So compact this, and this derivative from doing commercial PBX systems where you didn't want to have a hard drive and a whole bunch of complication on site if somebody could just go unplug and replug the PBX to get your office back running.
Yes.
So it's perfect for ham radio because sometimes you don't want to have to command line into something and mess around with a bunch of codes and hard drive crashes.
Yeah, that's the WinLink gateways that I have set up, the three or four of them that I have set up. They reboot themselves every night just because they can. And that way it doesn't get corrupt after sitting for weeks and days and what have you.
So through the years to continue, I got to know Jim. We talk on the phone a lot, and he'd always call me, and I was kind of his guinea pig because I was the lowest common denominator because I wasn't a programmer or a hardware designer. And he would say, okay, go to this website, download this new version of AllStar and test it out. So I was kind of like the test bed for the user base. And we became really good friends. And anytime he wanted to put a repeater on the air on a hilltop here in Southern California, he would call me. And I would be the guy that climbed the tower and installed the hardware for him because he was not too agile at the time to be able to do that kind of stuff. And so it was a good friendship. He would help me out with AllStar, and I would help him out building his repeaters.
Are y'all caught up, Gary?
I'm getting there.
You're getting there.
I'm stuck at the user level. I talk on my handy talkie to a repeater. How does this work? But you guys are deep into the how does it work. So,
well, I think that is important. So for Gary on his HT on 2 meters or 70 centimeters into the repeater down the hill from him or on the hilltop above him or whatever, what does AllStar mean for him, for that user?
So part of this, there is a common thread through most of the AllStar nodes in that the command set, unless you go in and you customize it, is pretty much the same for every AllStar node. There's a sequence of DTMF commands. You feed it to basically dial up your system to connect to another AllStar system. And this can happen anywhere in the world. From either end of the conversation. So I could sit here with my handheld and disconnect my local repeater in the garage from CalNet and hook it into a buddy's 900 megahertz system in Texas if I wanted to.
So
it's all a standard set of commands, which, again, are well published and are available to just about any ham who wants to. And we find that happens once in a while. We'll get somebody from their local repeater in New York City or Wisconsin or Texas, and they're just they're enjoying their local 2 meter repeater or 440 repeater in their hometown, and said, well, let's see, where else can I talk? Oh yeah, I've got a cousin that's visiting San Francisco. I wonder if there's a system in San Francisco I can send him on to hook up. So we've had a few casual vacationers keep in touch with family from back home by virtue that AllStar is basically openly accessible to anyone who knows the command set. And it's a pretty interesting way to approach things.
So is it designed mostly to be one repeater to another, dial up on demand, or multiple repeaters connect to each other and stay that way all the time, or any of the above?
Yes, all of the above.
Very flexible. That's the beauty of AllStar. It's so flexible. You can do just about anything. It's basically what Jim's describing. It's basically a telephone system for ham radio with shorter digits.
Yeah, there's no area code and phone number scheme of this at all. I guess maybe geographically we'll have to come to that as there are more and more nodes. We may have to renumber everything to indicate that. But numbers are assigned in sequentially from, you know, node number one all the way up to now. I think it's a six-digit number system. There aren't 480,000 nodes, but you can, you know, the node numbers are up in the thousands.
Yeah, we started with node 2000. That's where Jim started. That is actually a hub or reflector in a data center. And we're now in the 5000s. So we have, if you look on the allstarlink.org page, we now have over 5,000 nodes that are, you know, online and hooked up to the internet. That's a lot of nodes.
That seems like a key thing to go look at, David. AllStarLink.node.
Yep.
Node.
Yep.
AllStarLink.link. And what one of the beauties of some of the smarts that are behind this thing is that there is, it's got its own domain name system, as it were, because each node. To connect to another node, something's got to know the IP address of the other node. So that's done with a constantly updated directory that's spread out across a couple of data centers. So
did I get us to the right page here?
Yep.
Yeah. Go to lists and go to all star node lists. Yeah.
There we go.
And that is only going to bring up the first 20 if you
show 30. Show 30 nodes. Show all nodes. That'll probably take an hour, right?
Uh-oh, that's not good.
Is that bad? Do I show too many?
It's going to take a while for
I can do this. I can load it and I'll do a smaller list. Do a smaller list this time?
Yeah.
All right. See if I can get that page to load if I didn't muck it all up. Here we go. So there's 30. I could do 90.
So one of the things you can do in this is called filter over there is if you know somebody with somebody's call sign that they said they have an all-star node, but you forgot what it is.
I don't know any of those guys that have an all-star.
You can look them up and it will show all the nodes registered to them and their status.
There's a guy I know.
And how do they name things? Is it call signs? Is it?
When you register, you figure out what you want to fill in the blanks. The node number is the only thing that's.
And what did our buddy Jim name his site? Barf 6. Was there a Barf 1 through 5 before you got to Barf 6?
Well, but yeah, Barf 1 is actually 43039. But.
All right. Well, on here online, it's Barf. Actually, the second one's Barf too.
And then
what
does
Barf stand for?
Yeah. What does Barf stand for?
I'm going to say Bay Area Repeater something.
Bay Area Repeater Fellowship. It was, I inherited the primary system I have from the two-way engineer, the guy who ran Selectone, if you're familiar with their tone products. And he built what we believe is the third UHF repeater system here in the Bay Area. And it was all completely open system. And he decided to get out of the business and said, here's the keys of the repeater, and here's the gate code for the site. Good luck. Don't burn it up. So I just kind of kept that as its nickname.
So I'm searching local.
And you haven't burned it up yet.
You know, the neat thing about the filter is you can look up call sign. You can look up location, if you're traveling somewhere.
Uh-huh.
You can look up about anything that's on that on the list, and it will bring up that. The group what you're looking up.
First, I have to be able to spell.
What is the geographic distribution of the repeaters that are members of this? Is it concentrated anywhere? Is it kind of spread out everywhere? Is it U.S. worldwide?
I would say it's worldwide. There are all-star nodes everywhere. Most of it is in the United States. but there's a lot of European, a lot of nodes based in England.
Yep, Germany. Here's a whole list of them from Germany.
Yeah.
Long list.
So the one of the key things is everybody who signs up, because to have a node, it needs to have an identifying number, a node number, and that node number tracks back to the IP address that you'll dial into, so the system knows where to find another node. The node number is just a node number. Everybody has one, whether you bought one of the little hotspot kits that a couple of us, you can take this board and interface it to a Bofang and have an all-star node in your grandma's basement. A lot of people like tinkering doing that. And you can get a self-contained radio node. Marshall builds a couple of those.
And the board connects to your Bofang with just audio cables?
Okay, so the magic...
I think we're back to the cables that Marshall was talking about.
Yeah, well, those are IRP cables, right? No, I guess you said there were All-Star cables too.
So the implementation, when it migrated from the original one that's in Marshall's garage to Raspberry Pi, they needed a way to get audio in and out and some signaling in and out of the Raspberry Pi. And you could plausibly do that with the audio chip and the GPIO pins on a Raspberry Pi, but it's not a very good... it's not a very good audio chip. It's not very responsive, high performance. So there was a development, and I don't know the genre of this. You probably do, Marshall.
Yes.
That now somebody said, well, let's use one of these fancy super duper sound fobs, USB sound fobs, with a CM108 sound chip in it. And that chip, that plugs into a USB port. It has superb audio handling capabilities, and there are some little known signaling lines available on that sound chip that you can feed input to, which could be your PL detect, your CTCS tone detect. It can be your carrier present signal from a squelch chip. And it will output a push to talk signal that has got to be buffered and interfaced to the radio. So that's, I'll sneak this little thing in here as a plug.
Hold on. I can actually make it even better. Keep talking. There you go. What is that?
This is a Masters Communications RA42. And you'll see the sound chip right there.
Oh, keep going. Oh, yep. It's that little square chip. The square one.
So Kevin Custer is done all the homework and some of his radio interface magic with signal processing. So it will take all the signals you can imagine you need from a radio to detect that somebody's trying to connect into the system, and then push to talk. One of the beauties of this is you don't need this board. You could do this with just the sound chip and hack the sound chip. But while this thing will take an external logic of carrier present or CTCSS decode, the DSP function in the AllStar software is good enough that it can do your white noise squelch detection and CTCSS decode in software. So you have two ways to create a radio interface here. And the repeater in the garage is all, there is no external squelch board. There is no external audio processing or interface board. I plug the cable for one of these, directly into the receive discriminator line, from a Kenwood repeater. And I let the software, do all the detection and decoding of PL, and it'll handle multiple PL decodes. So it can be effectively a community repeater. It can do a lot of things, but most people will use an interface board, and you sort of have to use the interface board if you're plugging it into the back end of like an RLC or an SCOM controller, because they only know about logic lines. They don't do squelch decode and all those things. So you've got to provide that into your into the other half of it.
So to slide back, go ahead, Gary.
As when you're going to connect to your to your handy talkie, people quickly realize you need more than an audio connection in and out. You need push to talk to make the handy talkie transmit. And you need something from the handy talkie's receiver into your interface system to say, I'm receiving now. And those lines don't come out of a handy talkie.
Well, no, not easily. But most of the interfaces out of handy talkies, like a Bofang is a very popular radio to go hack into and pull this out of. There's enough white noise and enough low frequency bandpass coming out of a Bofang radio that you can use what we call the USB radio driver in the software to do carrier present and PL present detection out of the raw audio sound.
Out of the
handheld speaker lead. Yeah. It's kind of crude. Well,
what will be the
sounds like crap? But yeah.
Okay.
It does work.
Jim Dixon's favorite thing he had sayings, and he was a very funny, very very intelligent man, dry humor, and in the AllStar AppArt PT software there is Vox. So you can use Vox, but Jim used to always say, friends, do not let friends use Vox.
Yeah, Vox is... yep. And you want to get rid of squelch tails and stuff, so you probably have a little bit of delay.
There is hysteresis built into the white noise detection system, so it actually pretty much acts like a micro squelch chip. It understands what's going on, and... We'll give you a squelch tail if you're, you know, choppy and weak, and it will provide no squelch tail barf if it's a really strong strong signal.
Most people are not going to understand what a Micor squelch chip did. That's a 20-minute explanation, but basically,
it's sort of the gold standard of squelch systems that Motorola developed. And everybody's been trying to emulate it because it eliminated that annoying squelch burst when you unkeyed before there was, you know.
If the signal was above a certain threshold.
Yeah.
Let's just say if you're a repeater owner, you know what a micro squelch is.
Yes. Of the audience of Ham Radio Now right now, there are the two people that own repeaters are sitting on the screen.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm the audience advocate here at this point, which Jim gets frustrated at.
Well, and that's why we bring those folks here, because I don't own a repeater. You don't own a repeater, but we know guys.
Yeah.
Or Jim knows guys.
So to wrap it up in a nutshell, what Jim is trying to say is AllStar, the software, and is incredibly powerful and incredibly flexible, more so than any of the other Ham, I would say, based on my experience, and it is so flexible and so versatile and powerful, and it is free, open source, free to the world to use, or the ham radio world, or the commercial world, for that matter. There's endless possibilities. There's endless weeds that you can dive into with AllStar. It's almost overwhelming how many things you can change and configure.
So rather than leave the audience with this wide variety of things that they don't understand, let's detail a few of them. For example, down here there's maybe a dozen repeaters in something called the Fleet Talk, W4FTK Fleet Talk system. UHF and VHF repeaters up and down an interstate corridor that runs around Charlotte, North Carolina, down to Columbia, South Carolina, and then east and west across the South Carolina. And they use AllStar. I hear people dial in from non-radio systems, I think. But mostly it's just these linked repeaters. And yet, you know, they say it's AllStar, but then I don't hear anything else AllStar about it. Is it sort of self-contained? Can it go out to a bigger world? Can you tell from my description what they might be able to do?
Jim?
Okay. Well, there are a number of examples going on here. And one of the things when you immediately think of, oh, it's internet connected, well, then it's not ham radio. But yes, there are networks such as ours that will use AllStar as their linking capability rather than all the hardware investment, the doubling or tripling of RF investment at a site. Sometimes you can't get enough rack space to do it, so you want another way to get get your system connected to another system. And typically that would be over the internet. In many cases, the state of Hawaii is one of them, and I suspect maybe other states could offer this up to their ham community. There are private microwave networks carrying IP that are a good example of a way to stay in the hobby or stay resilient anyway. Apart from the internet being the interface, the link between systems. Aradin is another amateur radio project, which shows a lot of promise because it's handling, high density camera traffic. It can certainly handle a 64K voice over IP connection. So, as Aradin spans the continent and grows out in some areas, and it's going gangbusters here, is we can replace the internet connection that's holding these things together with Aradin nodes. So we'll keep it in the family that way.
Would the AllStar go away in that case, or they would still that still runs parallel to it?
You need an interface from the bits that come out of the microwave system to the analog radio side.
Got it.
So you would need an interface to do that for conventional FM. If you're doing DMR or system fusion, that's all its own native voice over IP bits on its Ethernet side.
Yeah. Aradin is a RF internet replacement using ham radio frequencies at 3.5 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz.
Yeah, two gigs, 3 gigs, and 5.8.
Yeah, which makes it point to point, and not going to say local, because you can where you got mountains, you can go pretty good distances, but it's not, you don't go nationwide with that.
It's point to point, but it's also a mesh system. So the idea is there's multi points, and it goes wherever it can. Yeah. Travel to move the data from one place to another.
Yeah, but there are what we'll call subscriber access into it. There's omnidirectional aspects at some of the main points of presence. Mm-hmm. So you can, from the ground, point at an Aradin node and be on that backbone.
Yeah, first or last mile, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's an option.
That's just a platform for putting AllStar on instead of using the internet.
Yes.
But most places, I'm going to guess, AllStar uses internet.
Yeah, and we've been fortunate here, even through the recent storms, that none of our sites have lost internet connectivity through all of this. So we've been in constant connection to Southern California through our storms and this debacle, which is, pretty good. I guess it speaks to the internet providers we have at various ends of the situation here.
Is it
as far as whether the user knows what's going on in the back end? some systems will choose not to share their unique control codes with their user base. They want to stay control operators, and they have the option to recode the system accordingly. The system software, like any Linux system, you can configure what's called cron jobs, or timed and scheduled jobs. So the system, if you were just basically an open system, but on Tuesday nights you wanted to provide AllStar services for one county's local areas group, and then on Thursday night you had a DX group that wanted a different set of repeaters connected in, you can just set up those scheduled jobs in one of your nodes, and suddenly your repeater system changes purpose and characteristic and audience on the fly, on a scheduled basis. You don't have to deliberately do that, which is kind of interesting, a cool way to do it.
Right, and some systems, just like other linking, they'll give the membership a code, and you can DTMF a code and take it online or take it offline or dial into whatever node.
Yeah, you can set up some pretty easy, you know, 3 or 4 digit macros rather than giving the secret sauce code behind it and then enable and disable those as you want. A couple other things. Well, one other popular thing that's going on, and I don't have my hotspot here, is a lot of people who travel who want to keep in touch with their home system, who've given up on Echolink, will go either build or buy a pre-built hotspot, which is basically a Raspberry Pi with a radio hat on top of it that's got all the interfacing in it. And he's got one.
That's like,
is that my next one?
Is that PiStar? Is that what the...
No, PiStar is a different implementation. PiStar is for the digital digital modes.
Got it.
But
hotspot's
out in the truck. So
when you use that, you'd still get your handy talkie out, and you would use your handy talkie to get to the hotspot, which would get you on the internet into whatever node you're dialed into or connected to.
Right, and my last cross country trip, there's a group I hang out with here that has a nightly happy hour. So wherever I was camping, I would dial into their node, and I'd join happy hour from Massachusetts or Tennessee, and then on Wednesday nights for the CalNet net, I'd dial up CalNet and be on be part of the net check in. And nobody could tell I was coming in from any other place in the universe, because while you could do it, there's no unique telemetry. There's no alert that says, "Oh, this is an external visitor. This is not somebody on the network close."
Right. You don't have to call for your on our weekly nets. We have to call and we have to pause for the guy that's on Echolink.
but that is sort of connected to a question I was going to ask. As the baffled user just on a local repeater, is there a way I can tell what that repeater is currently doing as part of the network?
It depends on the repeater. If you know the node number that might be associated with it, you can look that up. That's one thing David can bring up, is the node map of where we're connected through our system. It was called a bubble map.
Where's the map? Where's the map? I can't find the map.
List and stats.
List
and stats. If you click on a node.
Okay.
Go to node stats and maps, the third selection down.
Oh, maps. Yes, of course. Read. Words hard.
So pick one.
All right. Well, first I'm going to pick one of yours because that makes it real. Which one? San Francisco. Barf. I wanted the barf one. So just click on the barf. Click here for
all
the
right,
bubble chart.
Drum
roll.
Ta-da. So because we've got so many of these things, so many of these nodes, we set up, we commissioned a data center grade Linux implementation to host the AllStar software. And that's what everybody is pointing to. So while there are claims that a Raspberry Pi can take hundreds of connections, generally most people's internet connection can't handle all that traffic. So we didn't have a falling out however we connected daisy chained or otherwise, one of the other administrators of the AllStar cooperative built us a virtual machine in a data center, and that's what we connect to as our hub.
Okay, so if I wanted to do that, if I wanted to find out what the repeater's connected to, I got to go to the internet. There's a cool thing on DStar, one of the now ancient digital modes, where I can punch a code in, punch a button, and it will read back to me what that DStar node is repeater is connected to. What reflector typically?
If it's not native to the software, you can.
AllStar does that, Jim. It's called the connection status command.
I usually know what I'm doing, so I've never used it.
And would it read out in voice back through the repeater? Now that's going to be assuming that the people who set up the repeater put that function in and made it available to you, the user.
It's native. It's whether or not somebody disabled that function.
Yeah.
Yes. If using a DTMF command, you would be able to query the repeater you're talking into and it would tell you the different All-Star nodes that that repeater was connected to.
Okay. So I don't think my Fleet Talk system gives me those capabilities, but now I know at least what to go look at on their website to see if there's something that I just haven't been looking at.
And it's also possible that the FleetNet folks don't want to give you access to that, right? And they can block Gary
feeling that they use it just as an interconnection between right. their linked repeater systems. And they don't want all the outside connections and all the user functionality. They just are using it as a link system.
Well, and there is another configuration option. It's built into it. You can turn off the public facing aspects of this and not advertise your node. And you can do this all with private nodes. You can make up your own node numbers, and you have to manage the IP addressing for each of them, presuming you know what your system is, what your interconnect system is doing. My partner in crime up here in Northern California and I designed an All-Star node linked GMRS system for a local cert group, and it's all private All-Star nodes, so there's no public access to them at all. If you know the codes, a few of us control operators can punch the buttons and connect and disconnect them, but most of that user base doesn't even want to fool with that. They're cert members. They don't want to.
Yeah, they just know. They just know codes. turn their radio on the GMRS frequency or channel that you give them, and it'll do what it is you want them to do. You'll tie it in here or there or wherever it is.
And there's also a parallel GMRS linking project that they maintain a slightly different code set, different configuration, but they also manage a directory service, so you can All-Star link different GMRS systems.
And you got in trouble with your GMRS link one time because they all busted in on the ham system, if I recall.
Let me clarify that the GMRS systems that use All-Star are not part of the ham radio All-Star system.
Correct.
You do not cross-connect GMRS with ham radio. It's a no-no.
You shouldn't.
Yeah. Well, you theoretically you could, because you can manually configure any kind of permit deny access. You know, you could set up a private All-Star to All-Star connection between an amateur and a GMRS system.
Yeah, but as the control operator,
that would be
operator,
a really dumb thing to do.
Is it a control operator of the All-Star node? You're not checking people's GMRS licenses, just like you're not checking people's ham's licenses, depending on which end of the right the bad side they're transmitting on.
Yeah, well, if you hear a KMBH 399 come up.
Right.
On your repeater system.
Right.
I don't much sure that somebody screwed up.
I don't use my WROT 234 on the ham bands, just like I don't use W0DHG on the GMRS side.
Unless I pick up the wrong microphone.
And that does occasionally happen.
That happens.
So you guys are saying that there is an entry through an app on a phone. Is that, did I understand that correctly?
Yeah. The current, supported app. There's others that try. I guess you can do it with Zoiper. I haven't had much luck with that. The app that I have on my phone is, where'd it go? Is called DV Switch.
Okay, so this is what I've just dialed up from the Google Play Store, and there it is at the very top. I searched All-Star Ham Radio, and it said DV Switch, which confused me because that didn't look like what I was looking for, but that apparently is it, right above Echo
Voice Switch. So it's a voice over IP application for your phone.
Okay. So it's the one that I want,
and it's configured. It's designed to you could probably do anything asterisk based with it, but it's more specific. Its intent is to plug in an All-Star node number that you have permission for and that you're given a password for, and connect in.
Okay, so it's not for the general user just to go play in an All-Star network. You need to be part of it.
Well, you should know a little bit of something, and you should ask permission of somebody if you're going to do that with this app.
Okay. So once again, what I'm getting at is that the network is not designed for phone access like EchoLink might be.
You can
do it, but EchoLink promotes it.
Right.
AllStar has it.
Well, back to the thing that we didn't understand in the beginning, or we weren't communicating well. I can't, my understanding, well, he can't even see me, so holding this up doesn't make any difference. I can't pick this up and talk to EchoLink. I can use my cell phone to talk on EchoLink so that somebody on the RF side, on the UHF, VHF side of a repeater that has an EchoLink device connected to it, I can use my phone to talk to that person. But I don't use my radio to talk to the EchoLink system unless I don't understand how EchoLink works.
Well,
So AllStar has an EchoLink channel driver.
Oh, it'll do. Okay. All right. So that screws that whole idea.
AllStar will do EchoLink. So your AllStar node can also be your EchoLink node using the same hardware. You would have to configure the channel driver with your node, your EchoLink node, your call sign and your password and all the information you would need. And it can run simultaneously as an AllStar node or an EchoLink node.
Yeah, but that's at your repeater end of things.
Right.
And so that the user, once again, if they want to get into that AllStar thing with the EchoLink attachment, they're going in through the EchoLink app on their phone.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. And that was my point. Or their PC, because I had EchoLink on my Windows PC. Yeah.
Whatever.
It's not a HTRF into EchoLink, but AllStar, it sounds like.
Well, there's some other workarounds on AllStar where you really don't need an app, so to speak, to access AllStar. Mm-hmm. Since AllStar is an asterisk based system, you can set up an auto patch on AllStar. It could be a reverse auto patch where you can dial a number and come out on your node over the air.
From the public switched telephone network.
Yeah. Or you can set up an auto patch, a SIP phone where you can, over the air, you can dial into the phone system and make a phone call.
I never hear anybody do that. Is that something that happens much?
We have yet to do it. You need a SIP provider to do that. So you get a phone number. You can also
what's a SIP?
Session Internet Protocol, but a SIP provider is somebody who gives you digital phone services to set up a private PBX. You can buy a programmable Cisco VoIP phone and give it an IP address, and then you get a special SIP code that the rest of the phone network in the world knows how to get to that phone number.
So you can use that POTS phone. Yeah. So that's the pick up the POTS phone and dial that. The SIP is what routes it to Jim's VoIP phone or Marshall's AllStar node that has the SIP channel connected, plugged into it over the internet.
And there is this group that's they're doing, was it Ham Radio Hotline? I forget what that is.
Ham Shack Hotline. I got one
so
inside.
You can configure your AllStar node to be a Ham Shack Hotline input and output port. So you can interface it that way as well.
So more of that wide world of flexibility that the system is.
And then what Gary was asking, AllStar does have an application, or there's an application made by a gentleman who sells it for Apple devices. So you have to have an Apple, an iOS phone, but it's called Repeater Phone. And you can, it works just like EchoLink does, but on an Apple device. And you can.
Why would he limit himself to a small percentage of the world?
You know, a lot of people either write for Apple or they write for Android
Android. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
So I've heard.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's several aftermarket software to interface to AllStar or your AllStar network. The one I mentioned being a repeater phone. The other one is for Mac laptops, and I can't remember the name of it. It just, I'm having a brain, I'm brain dead right now. I can't remember the name of it, but it enables you to use your laptop to basically like Echo Link, where you can call from your laptop in and talk and listen to a repeater network or an AllStar node.
Is it transceive?
That's it. Transceive.
Yeah. So the Mac world can do this. Windows and Android world. We're left out in the cold.
Well, not necessarily. There is a program called IXRPT. It's shareware, and you can use that to dial in. That's Windows based. It has to be configured, but you can use, if you have the credentials, you can use that to interface to your AllStar node as well.
Is that a user designed function, or is that a controller designed function? I mean, is that for the cool kids on the repeater, or is that for everybody?
It's probably more tailored to the cool kids, because you have to have a password to access your AllStar node.
So if the repeater passes those things out, you can get in on it.
Yeah.
And maybe someday, again, my connection to AllStar is limited to this one network. And when I was visiting Hawaii, listening to one of the big repeaters on Mauna Loa, people were saying it's an AllStar net. Okay, cool. The word AllStar was moderately familiar. Didn't really tell me much other than I was sitting in Hawaii listening to a bunch of people in California. But I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't know what I could do with it other than I could probably talk back.
Yeah, Hawaii is a pretty good example of purpose-built state infrastructure that supports much of their area's operation. So there's a lot going on in the state microwave system that includes AllStar and a couple of other backbone connectivity systems over there. I just had a conversation with a gentleman who's trying to build up some repeater sites on the coast, and he said, yeah, there's some GMRS, there's some community interest in this and that. And I said, well, we can RF link them, we can AllStar link them. If community A and community B don't want to be connected all the time, but eventually if there's a big fire or a flood or a severe weather event and you want those communities connected together, then we can set it up so you can just hop on, hop off to connect those. I'm very keen on expanding our coverage of systems here, not having full-time CalNet systems, but having sister or partner systems who will allow us to connect to them and will allow them to connect to us. So that if I'm going over to the Monterey coast and my repeater doesn't have coverage, but there's nothing else going on the system, I'd like the discretion of not going to my hotspot or anything else, but dialing up Sam's machine and at Pigeon Point and hooking it to AllStar to CalNet for an hour or two while I'm over there, and then disconnect it when I leave. So there's a lot of promise for people who want to, you're going to build a repeater, and we hear a lot of folks say, well, there isn't any traffic on this repeater. I need a pair and I can't get one, but you're tying up a frequency and there aren't any users. This is a really good way to get more use, more effective RF time on a repeater that might otherwise lay dormant 90% of the time by inviting, visitors, guests. I encourage anybody who's, across the country who I see online, hey, I'm coming to San Francisco, is there a local repeater I can use or hook my brother up with as I arrange my trip? I tell them, sure, I'll give you San Francisco. If, there's going to be a lot of traffic, I'll take it off of CalNet. You guys can have a, family discussion every night. And then, we'll put it back on CalNet when you guys are done using it. So it's very flexible that way. And anybody who knows the commands, we have not customized our command set to preclude anybody coming in and doing something. So if they know it's an AllStar node, their DTMF pad is the keys of the kingdom, as far as connecting anywhere in the world. So one way to stay a community linked system without being private.
Yeah. Having that stuff is very cool. My experience is that most hams will not drive a repeater to any place other than it's already just sitting. They feel uncomfortable doing it. They are not, maybe they haven't practiced it enough. And then they worry that, well, wait a minute, this is a big community resource, and now I'm going to tie it up for my personal use. How long is reasonable? I'm not going to connect back to my repeater on the other side of the country for 12 hours.
Well, funny you should mention that, because one of my drive time adventures connecting my system to friends back in Texas, I drove out of control range of the repeater. So about an hour later, I got a really pissed off email from somebody saying, you just ran out of coverage and left us hanging here. But luckily, we know how to disconnect you. But don't do that again. Okay. And so you run that risk. You can write some timing macros that once an hour, or once every 2 hours, just reset the node to its default configuration. So if you went off and left it and you come back to it, 3 hours later. Oh, and you can set a different set of courtesy tones depending on what mode the thing is in. So I've got one of my systems here letting me know. We have a standard beep configuration here that one beep you're offlink, a beep boop, and you're linked on the system. I do the reverse with my machine here at home, and I have it give me a boop if I'm getting link traffic. So, it's quite a bit of fun to put in some bells and whistles. And when I know, in case I'm not around and the other people here don't do control, when we come up to our weekly net, 10 minutes before the net, Marshall will probably kill me for doing this, but he hasn't said anything yet, is 10 or 15 minutes before the net, I reset my nodes and make sure they all point back to the main node to guarantee that they're online for net time. If they've fallen off or, just forgot to connect, or I was doing something and I walked away from it, 8 o'clock Wednesday nights, all the nodes go back and reconnect to the mothership and make sure people can use them.
Go ahead. Gary,
I think your question was, what's an acceptable time if you're a visitor to tie up a repeater to talk back home?
Yeah, good question.
I think that is totally up, as a courtesy. I don't think I would show up on a repeater without first maybe contact, if I'm going to use it for an extended, more than maybe say 15 minutes. I think I'd try to get a hold of the folks that run the repeater and ask.
Good luck with that. You can't find people who run repeaters. They hide. They disappear. They are ghosts.
You might find the guy says, talk all week. I don't care. I've looked up repeater owners before, emailed them, and
Well, in our case, if I'm not around and some guest comes up and says, hey, I'd like to use San Francisco for a while or whatever else, I fully trust Marshall's judgment to make that call for me. We're all peer friends, and we've Marshall's been to all of our sites. I have not been to any of Marshall's sites. So one day I got to make the Southern California round trip. But we're all one, part of one big happy family. If Marshall says, hey, Jim, there's a problem on your machine, I had to take it off link, I have to trust his judgment. That's just the way it works. If Thousand Oaks goes off, then hey.
You guys breathe rarefied air. I have been fortunate enough to live in the rarefied air of the repeater owners and the repeater controllers. But I also live in the world of the ordinary ham, and we don't breathe that air. We don't talk to you guys. You don't talk to us. We don't know how to contact you, especially in a 5-minute span. I drive into town. I look you up on repeater book. I see, oh, that seems to be a network node. Let me see if I can punch some buttons and make something happen. I don't feel comfortable playing with your repeater, and didn't plan to make a connection with you guys. Talk to the audience. Tell them what to do.
Well, we'd like to see more people get involved in this, because I think it's as one of the things that that's newcomers to the hobby, We've got a lot of people that are gravitating to DMR and hotspots, you know, at home. And this is one way to get them out of, get people out of the hotspot, you know, recliner, and get a little more engaged in radio. And maybe build something cooler, better, you know. That's part of why I wanted to do this this show, is to let folks know there's a little more open architecture that, you know, is a little more accessible around the country if you really want to play radio and not just, Skype calls with a handy talking.
Yeah, there is what I call the hotspot versus repeater conundrum. Because I've got the hotspots, and I feel comfortable on the hotspots, jumping from one network to another, listening for a bit, seeing if anybody's out there, nobody's talking, jump to another network. I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that on the repeater, and yet I've heard repeater people say, please, please, the repeater's been dead all day. Please, come on the repeater and play.
Well, this gives you a little bit different, probably more deliberate interaction by using DTMF control to do what the talk groups and the color codes and all that entitlement in DMR is pre-programmed to do. This breaks you out of that box of having to have you have to have an All-Star ID, but it unbinds you from the whole talk group constraint of, program in the worldwide talk group in my DMR talkie. And I got to go someplace, go back home and reprogram my radio. You don't have that problem here. You spin the VFO dial, and you got a DTMF pad, and you got permission. And maybe as part of expanding directory nomenclature, maybe on the All-Star node, guest welcome to, connect from, externally. And visitors local to the area are welcome to try it. That's something we haven't accounted for in the open versus closed situation. You obviously don't have that in DMR, because if you created a worldwide talk group, there's no controlled access to it. If you've advertised it and it's on Brandmeister or Radio ID, everybody's good to go. This gives you a little more flexibility to be a active participant rather than just a user.
So there are worldwide talk groups within, or whatever you call them, in AllStar.
Well,
where there might be lots of traffic going on all day long.
Yeah. Yes.
And so I'm a local guy and maybe I'm a visitor, but I'm listening to a repeater that's been silent for 4 hours and I'm a little bored, and I say, I want to dial that repeater up to something that's going to be playing me traffic. As the repeater owner, you haven't dedicated the repeater to play that traffic all day long. But as the user, I might say, well, I'm bored maybe for 10 or 15 minutes. Can I dial up and just monitor that traffic and maybe talk back if somebody's talking about something I want to talk to? Would you rather have somebody err on the side of doing that than err on the side of saying, ooh, I don't feel like it's my place to dial this repeater up to something that busy?
That's where I think we need another descriptor column. Guests, feel free if you're in the neighborhood, if you want to, pop up on your brother-in-law's repeater back in Indianapolis, feel free to punch the button, because there are enough of us control operators on all the time. If we find something that's not right, we'll catch it and reconfigure it pretty quickly. And we also have the feature saying, okay, whatever you've dialed up, we're going to reset in an hour. So you got an hour of time to Indianapolis, and if you need an hour and 10 minutes, you got to dial it up again.
Yeah. That shows up one of the advantages of the DMR system, because the DMR system has two channels, always has two channels. And so you can play on one and know that you're leaving the other one for the local guys. I still don't hear very many people doing that. On a analog FM system where you're going to tie up the whole thing with your current goal for 15 or 20 minutes of playing, well, you're going to be doing that and got to decide if that's what you feel comfortable doing. I'm going to lean toward telling the audience, give it a try. It's better to it's better to seek forgiveness than permission.
Yeah, what's the worst thing that's going to happen? Is they're going to ask you to get off their lawn?
Yeah.
Right. Or they're going to dump. Or they're going to dump the connection on you, which would be like saying, "Get off my lawn."
Well, and there are a couple of more exclusive or closed. Call them closed. I hate to use that term, but there are a couple of systems out there that if they hear traffic that they don't like, they're not even going to talk to you. You're going to hear one blip of DTMF before it mutes, and the machine is going to be dead for a couple of hours.
Yeah.
Just, you know, that's their passive aggressive way of kicking you off.
Yeah. And once again, you've driven into town, you looked it up on repeater book. Repeater book had its usual cryptic information about the repeater. Didn't tell you very much. Said it's an all-star node. You try doing something and they blip you off. What can you do? You haven't lost anything.
I would say that the odds of that happening are maybe 1 in 10 or 1 in 20. I think you'd have a more positive experience.
I would hope so. Yeah, I would certainly hope so. Again, sometimes I'm the guy in charge of the repeater and somebody comes on and does that and they seem to be stumbling their way around, I'll come on and say, "Can I give you a hand? I'm glad to have you here."
We do that all the time. Yeah. Yep, definitely. That's the spirit of ham radio.
I think
somebody off the air.
The repeater systems down here that I use occasionally. Yeah, if there's nobody on the air, then you can connect it to here or there or wherever, so that you could talk to somebody else. And I think in the process, if you put your call sign out, nobody's responded. Eventually, somebody will jump on. I think there's always somebody lurking. It's just a matter of do I pick up the microphone and talk to them or don't I? Or as you said, do they pick up the microphone and DTM you off the air? But you know, it's probably few and far between that would happen.
Well, we've had a couple occasions where people are going, you know, I'm sitting up here and I'm in San Francisco visiting and I'm trying to get a hold of my brother-in-law who's on CalNet in San Diego, and you know, is the link broken someplace? And if they just pop up, one of us is going to go, "Let me punch around a little bit," and oh yeah, that node disconnected itself. Or I'll call Marshall and go, "Hey, did the hub go down? Did we lose a link radio at Snow Peak or something?" And I go, "By God, you're right. Somebody troubleshot it. You know, found us a problem."
Yeah, I wouldn't want
to do this weekend.
I wouldn't want a new ham or a ham that doesn't understand the topography of the systems very well to think that repeaters have control operators hovering over them. Like, how long has it been since we've had telephone operators hovering over the phone system? You dial O. That doesn't exist anymore. But you're not going to find on most repeaters instant help from somebody monitoring who really knows what's going on. You might not find anybody who even doesn't know what's going on.
I think we lost.
Depends on the system, but that's not something you can count on.
It's one way to encourage that engagement, because if you got a repeater sitting out there in Omaha that's not getting a whole lot of use, as long as you're not a curmudgeon control operator and you want some more activity, yep. what better way to to get somebody young and new who you can hand this off to rather than leave it to be trashed in your estate.
And if you've got 5, 10, 15 repeaters in town, a few of them can carry all day network traffic, even though probably they haven't had a local signal on them in 2 weeks. You got something for the people to listen to. You definitely want repeaters on the air that are just for local traffic. So like I said, you got 5, 10 repeaters floating around your area. 5 and 10 repeaters is a small town. Big cities will have 50 repeaters. Why not have a few of them carry network traffic all day long from around the world?
Fascinating. And people there are a number of systems that dedicate themselves to being, the all-star in town. And they're just there specifically for that, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
I think we lost the YouTube. I think
YouTube went down. I'm seeing chat.
We may have lost we may have lost all of the chat. I'm not sure. Let's see. It thinks it's doing.
I just saw. Sorry, YouTube. I think we lost
that,
you.
That was me.
That was you.
No. Yeah, because it popped up saying the YouTube stopped.
I do see YouTube
trying to
connect. Round and round and round.
Yeah.
And then it just blipped out to
the wheels on
the end of show.
No more.
Billboard options.
So hey,
did your green button go off?
Yeah, it did. And I had a pop up. I am still recording local, so we can keep doing the show, and I'll just repost it tomorrow. won't be the end of the world. Don't let that stop us. Just act like I'm actually doing the show the right way.
Are we still on Facebook?
Yes, sir. I think we are. No, I don't know. Yeah, actually it does, because it says I could stop it, but I can't start it. So let's see. Can I start? But I can't start the other thing.
You can on an individual start.
Yeah.
You go up to your output, start, stop broadcasting.
Right. And, you know, the YouTube just says connecting. So I'll go into the settings.
Marshall, keep, this is a control ops trying to figure out what happened.
All right, you guys keep doing the show, and let me just do this in the background here. What happened? Oh, no.
Yeah, that was happening to me when I had my, I was trying to feed YouTube too high a bandwidth, and it would choke.
I don't know.
So.
Wow.
Maybe that's why you got that. You might be trying to choke YouTube with too high a data rate.
I guess it's possible.
So, yeah, I just went through show notes, and I guess I didn't share them all out with everybody. It was just stuff I was spitting out on paper. One of the things that I'm going to pursue, there will be somebody I know who's deeply embedded in FirstNet when I get to Quartzfest. And I'm going to ask him some things because you can backhaul AllStar on a FirstNet, you know, hotspot connection. So, you know, is there something FirstNet adjacent to this? And, you know, perhaps Verizon's equivalent. And also ask, you know, how Verizon's going to tie into some of this eventually. Because at some point, one of the flexibilities is you can carry around a mobile hotspot. It's not too hard to set one of these up. If you needed to get a couple of things connected on the fly, AllStar is probably one of the quickest ways to get it done.
And you just need an internet connection there to get on the air.
Right. Somewhere along the line there has to be one, and whether it's FirstNet or, you know, Verizon backend provided or whatever else, that's one way to go.
I'm not a good network guy, but these look like internet connections, you know, with IP addresses and stuff.
The Raspberry Pi is just an internet connection. It's just
As you're going into the internet, or you're going into FirstNet, or you're going into whatever Verizon's going to do, all these things look to your device like the internet, right? With just an IP.
Right. Well, it's a network connection, and as long as it can reach out, find the IP address of the target node number you're looking for, it will try to make that session connection. Yeah.
And so then, if it's the FirstNet, needs to have a connection to the internet, where your remote AllStar node is connected to. Marshall's going, maybe not.
No. Any network AllStar will work on. It does not need to be the internet.
If you want to go to an AllStar node that is not on your local network.
Yeah, that would not work. But if you wanted to set up something, say on FirstNet, node to node, that could be done. Not part of the internet.
Right. So earlier you guys were talking about audio quality, and you made you tossed a little bit of shade over at Echolink, which was warranted because Echolink generally sounds terrible.
Well, a lot of that is because
AllStar, the group that I listen to here, the group of repeaters, you wouldn't know anything's linked. They all sound what I'm going to call ham radio great.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say before, you know, when we do our weekly ArriesNet on the Darn system, and they have Echolink, and apparently they have AllStar as well. When we have to stop,
you can tell who's on Echolink.
We have to, well, not only that, but we have to stop and pause for the Echolink so that they can key up on the PC side to drop their call sign in and their check in, whereas our friend Bernard Jim will check in on the AllStar from wherever, and it just sounds like he just keyed up an HD or his mobile radio. You can't tell the difference, and it's, you know, in real time, and there's no waiting or pausing or anything like that.
So what's the magic?
It's the AllStar.
The magic is that there are a dozen what are called codecs, or the the digital to analog audio translation back and forth that have got they've got different bandwidth that they will accommodate, and they have different rules for within that software of how much error they can take before they can't put the conversation back together again, the audio stream. So we, in our configuration, picked the best codec possible as the first one to negotiate, because we know our, we know what our systems, you know, because we're configuring all our systems. But there are alternate codecs, if you don't have the bandwidth in your connection, that you can drop down to a lower quality digital voice connection. And sometimes we can't tell the difference, but sometimes we can if somebody's done it. Echolink does not give you a choice. And you also have people, if they're doing Echolink from their PC or their phone, there's no telling how good the audio quality is from your Bluetooth headset to the noise in your truck cab.
Oh, no, there's telling, Jim, it's going to sound bad.
Well, but even the best of the best going into Echolink comes out not so great.
It's going to sound bad.
It's using GSM codec. That's why. Yeah. It's a lower quality sounding codec. So you're starting with a lower quality from the get-go.
It's not going to get any better, yeah.
Yeah.
And if you overdrive it, it's just going to get horrible. And when I hook into my systems with the DV switch app for my Android phone, if I'm in a pretty clean environment, nobody can tell I'm not talking to Southern California by radio, from up here, because it just sounds that good. Maybe it's the Android phone. Maybe I don't try to talk in noisy environments, but, generally in AllStar, you can't tell how somebody's getting into the system.
And so let me ask a question out of left field. Have they considered utilizing Codec 2 in any way?
That would be a question for the software architects.
I've heard people ask about that on the AllStar
The only reason for asking is because Codec 2 is open source and was designed by a ham for not exclusive use in ham radio, but because ham radio needed an open source codec. And so it's there and it's flexible. And now if the guys who put together the AllStar systems have access to proprietary codecs, I don't have any problem with them using them, but some hams will say, we got one, why not use it?
I think where the limitation lies on that is the fact that the AllStar or app RPT system, the software that basically controls the radio into VoIP, is actually riding on Asterix, which is a PBX system. So I think the limitation of codecs is Asterix based, where there's only certain codecs that can be used. And
okay, so it's not AllStar is not all ours to play with as we wish.
Right. It does have constraints based on Asterix constraints.
Okay. I mean, it's a reasonable answer. It just, hams will say, we got one. Those who know what Codec 2 is will say, we got one, why not?
Well, we know who to ask.
Well, and, Asterix is open source, right? So someone could, Gary, if you're interested in updating Asterix,
I'll become a programmer.
That's right. You too could sit down and figure out how to get Codec 2 in there. And that, maybe help.
Yeah. And maybe it's totally inappropriate. I don't know.
So the AllStar Link website, go ahead, Marshall.
A lot of the features that are in AllStar are because a ham will say, hey, how come we don't have this feature? And they will write the code. And because the code is open source, they'll upload it to GitHub. And it's available for the whole community to use, because that's the whole spirit of what Jim Dixon gave to the ham community, is this open source technology that's available for anybody to use, with the agreement that if you use it and you add something better, that you share with everybody and not charge.
And that works for the ASL builds. and doesn't always hold for the other version of
So there's different All-Star there's different branches. I was going to ask, the All-Star Link, the page that we brought up, is kind of a conglomerator of all of the nodes and the information. But the All-Star Network doesn't need the site to live. This is really a utility to allow you to figure out, I can get here or there, or I can find this guy or that guy or that repeater set, or do they, are they kind of intertied together and you have to have them both?
Okay, so there is a DNS system mm-hmm. that knows the address, the IP address of all the nodes. And mm-hmm. so when you go to make a node connect, the first thing it does, just like a browser, is says, where are, you know, who am I trying to connect to? What's their IP address? Mm-hmm. And there is a second registration system with a different DNS protocol built into another version of software that does not use the All-Star DNS system. And that came about because one, for a period of time, All-Star was just growing so fast that its DNS system couldn't always handle the traffic. That problem has since been fixed, and you know, there's been no known failures of, you know, connection or dropout, or you can't find anybody for the last 3 or 4 years since I've been involved with this. So there are other versions of the software and implementations of Asterisk that are not open source, regrettably.
Yes.
Got it. But for the all, so when I think of Jim or Marshall at your house, your All-Star node or the All-Star node that's running the darn network down here, which I looked on the All-Star link page here and I saw that they're there. Is there somewhere a server or servers that manage that whole beyond the All-Star link that manages the whole, you know, you got to sign this number and you got to sign that number and you got to sign this number, and there the connections in between them are all through that, or is it point to point? Hey, Jim wants to connect to Marshall's All-Star node, and it just does it over the internet, and there isn't any.
Well, so part of that is there is the IP addresses can be cached mm-hmm. at your local node. So mm-hmm. as long as Marshall's node doesn't change IP address,
mine don't.
Uh-huh. You know, we go right to. We look up ourselves first locally mm-hmm. before we say, hey, I don't know where this node is. I have to go look for I have to do a DNS.
You don't need the mothership somewhere to make all that happen.
You don't always need the mothership unless it's a new connection. But if you happen to know, you know, the guy you want to deal with on the other end, mm-hmm. You could hard code that in, or you could add it to that lookup yourself. Mm-hmm. Which kind of takes you into the territory of doing a private node, which we have not elected to do with our system yet.
But to answer your question, David, mm-hmm. for the most part, a default All-Star node will need the backend servers that are all run by allstarlink.org.
Okay, so you do kind of manage all of that. So yeah, if I decided, hey, Marshall, I'm going to buy an All-Star node from you, or you're going to help me hook one up, I need to go to this All-Star link and register it before it'll actually do anything.
Right. You'll need to get a node number, which is managed by
AllStarLink. Okay. So, all right. So we do need you.
Right. You'll get a node number uh-huh. and you'll get a secret password. And that's part of the security to make a connection. So your node will do several things when you plug it in. It's going to send you're going to type in that secret password when you configure your node. And then your node is going to use an IAX2 protocol, and it's going to send that password to a security registration server. And the security registration server is going to look at your node number that you've sent along with your password and match the node number to the password to make sure you're a real node. And if those two... if the node number and the secret password are correct, then your node will show up as registered in the DNS system and push out that information to all the other nodes on the network. So there is some level of security, mm-hmm. and there are backend servers that are being used for 99% of the people that are on the AllStar network.
Right. So that security means that somebody can't poach your node number if they don't have your password.
Right.
But if you wanted to have, like in the case of this one GMRS system, if you wanted to have something that's completely off the internet, but you know who they are, then you can configure private node numbers on your own. And yes, there's an address where there's a node range to do that specifically that is not tracked by AllStar.
So not completely off the internet, completely off the AllStar system.
Yes.
Yeah.
Still
yes.
On the internet.
Well, yeah. you could do it on private networking as well.
Which is
one implementation was. It was an in-city private IP network that does not have any internet connection.
Yeah, but also totally disconnected from anything else AllStar.
Right.
Yes.
Cool.
Does that answer your question? Yes. AllStarLink.org is the official group. There are many flavors of software, but there's a group that does closed source software for the Raspberry Pi, Ham VoIP. There's contention among the AllStarLink.org guys and Ham VoIP, because Ham VoIP, they took the work of Jim Dixon and made it closed source and didn't share. But either software can be used on the AllStar Link system. But
yes,
the closed software or the open AllStar Link software. It's like the difference between Chevy and Ford.
Is it legitimate to take something open source, fork it, and close it?
What was that?
Is it a legitimate thing to take open source software like AllStar, fork it, you know, make it, you know, put your own stuff in it and then close it off and not give it back? Is that a legitimate thing in the open source community?
Their argument is they are sharing the software. They're just not sharing the source code.
Which makes it no longer open source.
Right.
Correct.
They'll let you use the software, but not have the secret sauce.
That is correct.
Right. Did they make it better? They think they did.
Right, exactly. Yeah. How long is a piece of string?
Well, they chose a different operating system, which behaves differently on different platforms. Is it better? Not necessarily. I mean, the basic functions. I have a mix of nodes that use the AllStar build, and just to make sure everything is on the up and up, if somebody wants to bring a Ham VoIP node onto the system, I've got some Ham VoIP nodes. Just so we know that we're going to have interoperability. We will know pretty quickly by the number, as much as we build and rebuild nodes just for our own edification, we'll know very quickly if something got broken on one side or the other.
But what I can say for the new Ham that has no experience in Linux and does not want to spend a lot of money and wants to build their own node and wants to use a Raspberry Pi to build the node, if they can find one, it's probably going to be easier for them to use the Ham VoIP closed software, unfortunately, in my honest opinion. It's easier to use for the new guy starting out. It's easier to set up, configure, and whatnot. They've done a very good job tailoring the software to a specific hardware set. You can't use the Ham VoIP software on a PC or at a data center on a server. It's tailored particularly to a Raspberry Pi. So it does have limitations, but it's very easy to set up versus maybe the AllStar distribution type software is a little harder to tailor to a Pi, Raspberry Pi. Would you not agree, Jim, on that?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I mean, once you get inside either one, I usually operate on the inside guts. When I'm reconfiguring a node, I'm SSH, terminal process, command line, you know, into the system. You know, you may use the initial setup menus, the beginner menus to get things going, But when it comes down to some internal features, customizing the timers, IDs, beep, you know, your telemetry tones, you know, various things we do to make a node act like a CalNet controller, that stuff we all do at the command line. And for that, some of those features are in a common directory structure between both versions of software. If you're doing anything with the web interfaces or some other functions, the directory structure is different between the two of them, and you have to kind of keep track in your head where they are. One of the pieces of software that lets you monitor your node, Supermon, has been developed specifically for the Hamvoit version. It's a newer version of Supermon that they've customized. But it didn't take me but an hour to figure out how to alter the directory structure of my my AllStar builds and get Supermon 6 or 7 or whatever it is working on the AllStar version.
All right, we've been going at this for an hour and 50 minutes. Jim, you talked a little while ago about showing something.
Oh, well, I sort of did.
You did that. Okay, got it. Sorry, I missed out on that. I thought you were screen sharing something else. Right.
So aside from focus you thing.
Right. That's the radio interface. Is it also the hat to the Pi board?
Marshall specializes in hats with RF decks built onto them.
Got it.
I've got one. It's out in the truck. It'll be making the trip with me to keep me connected to starting out tomorrow.
Right. Okay. So that's what Marshall's showing is that's the last mile, right? That's me to my HT. And what you showed us, Jim, that's on the repeater side.
Right, but you could use this if you don't want to invest in a radio, you know, in that board, mm-hmm. which is a very, very clean, nice RF implementation. Mm-hmm. I've got one. I'm very impressed with the choice of chip on this. That comes in a VHF or a UHF model, a very clean RF package. But if you can get a Pi and you want to do your own, you can roll your own. Using a genuine CM108 109 sound chip fob, which is his sound chip is right there by the push button. I'm pointing at my screen.
Mm. Oh, I spotlighted it. Let's see if I can bring it up again. There
okay.
We go.
But a lot of folks getting into this, they went out and bought an extra Bofang and, you know, dug into some of the how to's on YouTube and whatever else and ran three or four wires out of their Bofang. And opened up a USB sound fob and found the tiny little places to do the interface connections. So you can build a node out of a Bofang and a $9 sound fob. You know, it's not really clean. It's a Bofang, so it's not going to be really RF, wonderful. It's hard to build a duplex node, out of Bofangs because they'll mess with each other. If you're not comfortable doing the sound fob thing, there are a couple of companies, that build these interface boards, purpose built, and Kevin Custer's Masters Communication builds all kinds of interface boards for,
David, switch the shot.
I'm sorry. Where'd I go? Well, no, we're not showing anything. What, this shot?
You're showing Marshall sitting here listening to Jim.
No.
When Marshall, it's kind of cool. If Marshall rolls his eyes or shakes his head, then I know I'm going off.
I have to pull the pin.
That's valuable.
One of the easiest ways, if you're not really good with detailed soldering, is you go to Masters Communications and you can buy a board that's already stuffed. I buy my boards as a kit form with a bag of resistors and capacitors, and I go out on the bench and spend a nice cathartic hour and a half put my own board together because I like building stuff.
So just to be complete, the already built up hot spots like the open spot, things like that, none of those will talk to AllStar. Am I correct?
An open spot will. So there are two kinds of hotspots. There's the digital, the DMR, the Fusion, the D-Star hotspots, which use basically a 433 megahertz key fob RF chip. It's like, you know, you find in your car keys.
is that what they use to get out of RF from?
Yes.
That is horrible.
It's not a real radio chip. And you find that out when you go look at the specs, that the thing is programmable from DC to light, and the impedance, there's no 50 ohm impedance anything in the thing. The antenna connections, the RF connections, the impedance varies by what frequency you use it on. So you get these guys taking a $9 key fob chip that's say 180 ohms to an SMA connector and saying, well, I want to extend my range, and they plug a 50 ohm antenna into it, and there's no RF filtering on those things. So they're just horrible. I've got a DMR hotspot with, you know, PiStar thing. It was got it off of Amazon or eBay, you know, China for, you know, 20, 30 bucks. You can make a DMR hotspot, but, it's just not good radio. But I encourage anybody who wants to get
a key fob radio.
Yeah. It's an interesting thing. Technically to get into this, if you're not really good at detailed soldering, is go to Kevin's site, you know, buy this board. If you've got a pie laying around,
there's many sites to buy interface boards. Kevin's not the only guy. He does a good job of what he does, but there's several options. And basically a radio interface board is basically a sound fob, a USB sound fob with connections to interface your radio, a few extra parts, no black magic, and a specific sound chip. That's it.
Okay. So what I was missing was the idea that my open spot is a digital thing, purely D-Star DMR fusion, not analog. So that need not apply, but there's other stuff out there that you can get that's pretty much all ready to go. David, you are presenting us with a very interesting collection of screens.
Sorry.
Do you have any idea what you're doing on that end?
I do, and actually I think I'm not showing you guys what I'm recording. Oh. And I think that's the problem. I think I'm supposed to be on this screen, but I'm really on that screen, which is, you know, it's going to be what it's going to be.
Okay.
It's like David's not even part of the show.
I have been on and off. That's the part that you can't see. And we're getting to the 2-hour point. So the question that I have is, what didn't you tell us, or what didn't we ask about AllStar?
How about the digital to analog bridge that can be done with AllStar software?
The digital to analog bridge.
The digital to analog is fine with the digital people. It's the analog to digital side that they hate. You know, analog signals for some reason on the digital modes sound terrible.
If you fed them bad audio, you'll get bad digits out.
At the very best, full quieting, noise-free signal approach is acceptable. And you add a little bit of flutter and weak signal noise, and it is just horrible. The codecs don't know what to do with it.
A lot of that's going to depend on what your audio source is. If you're taking speaker audio and shoving it through one of those, you're missing a whole lot of dynamic range and things that the digital wants to know. Digital wants your voice to process. It does not want speaker audio to process.
So you want to go back to what, discriminator? If such a thing is even findable in a radio anymore?
Well, it's detector output. You know, it can be a slope detector or whatever. But the better you feed it.
Yeah, early unprocessed audio somewhere in the receiver chain.
Yeah.
Which, once again, is not the domain of most of our audience.
Right. But we have...
Nobody does that, because what I hear on the air, what little I hear on the air is... just horrible.
Yeah.
On the digital networks that have an analog input.
Well, Marshall and the guys have facilitated, we've got a DMR bridge. and with a decent DMR radio, it sounds pretty good coming out the analog side. I think the Fusion, is the Fusion bridge up, Marshall?
There is. We don't have a Fusion bridge right now. We have just the DMR bridge.
Right.
The Fusion repeaters, that's the whole idea. Fusion is to go analog to digital, digital to analog. I don't think it was a great idea to start with, but that's their whole idea. Evidently, in their repeaters, in Yaesu's repeaters, they know where to pick off the analog audio to feed it to the digital transmitter and make it sound least worst.
Yeah. Well, we get into the weeds with Fusion or C4FM versus DMR, but the C4FM is error corrected and DMR is fire and forget. So with fire and forget, sometimes pieces get lost and what comes out the other side might not sound as good as something that has forward error correction.
Yeah, that takes a pretty bad DMR signal to sound that bad. I mean, I listen to a lot of DMR and most of it sounds pretty good.
For the most part.
Yeah. It takes a signal that's building up a lot of bit error to start getting, and that's a pretty weak signal and when you say there's no correction, I thought there was forward error correction in the DMR system, but I'm no expert.
From what I understand, no, but hey, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But
we'll have to go look it up. We can Google it.
Yeah. All right, David, anything else?
I think that my brain is full. And there may be questions going forward, but who knows? We'll have Marshall back. But
we'll never know because we're not on the air.
Yeah. No, we are. We are. Well, I'm saving it. I'm not sure what happened. We've been restreaming for 31 minutes, and it says it's streaming to at least the YouTube, but I'll save it and upload it tomorrow. But I do want to thank you, Marshall, and Jim and Gary for coming to hang out tonight. And tell us about AllStar.
Yes, I got lots of information that I can go forward and start learning more about what's going on here. I appreciate it, Marshall. Sorry for seeing curmudgeonly at the beginning.
Well, it's like I didn't do show notes like I wanted to. You know, it didn't get them out there, and but I think the good point is getting this technology, the ease of implementation without specialized radios. It's not exactly a solution waiting for a problem. It's a solution with many opportunities that I see a lot of people trying to solve with crossband repeating or some other method. And sometimes a simple point-to-point Wi-Fi or something, may provide an answer for somebody that's approachable with equipment they've got. So without buying a pair of DMR radios and a hotspot and loading it up for, it used to be you could build a node for when pies were $35, you could build a node for under $100, but try to find a pie.
They'll be back.
Eventually.
They're coming.
Eventually.
They're coming.
All right. Well, how do we close the show tonight?
Do you need me to play the music again?
I need you to play the music. We have to decide who's gonna talk us out. And I'm gonna try to make the screen roll go at the end. We'll keep our fingers crossed.
This was episode 416 of Ham Radio Now, an AllStar Cast. And I don't know the rest of the outtake.
I can say that.
Here we go. We can go. We can go from here. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. You're
Jerry Pierce, K4AQ, the King of Ham, from the top of the King Con lift
and
at Park City, Utah.
Jim
Aspinwall, NO1PC, with special thanks to our guest Marshall, K6PC.
And Marshall Oldham, KE6PCV from Corona, California.
Excellent.
7-3, everybody.
Over.
And.
Out.
Okay.
Well, that timed out perfectly.
We may need to tune the piano. It sounded a little off key in the background there.
I didn't plan that at all.
When I tried to play the show close, I don't know if it happened or not.
I saw it, something going on in one of the 10 different screens I'm getting back from. So.
All right, we're going to work on that too. Well, thank you guys. And I don't think I'm going to do an after the show tonight. I'm going to go figure out what happened to the why we're not streaming anymore. Part of the
I'm supposed to. I'm supposed to be in a truck southbound at 12 hours from now.
Yeah,
you stay with me on the Zoom, and we'll debug it for a second here.
For a second or David. Three. Thank you so much, Marshall, for joining us tonight. And drive safe tomorrow, Jim.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm gonna be putting Marshall's hotspot to work when I'm in the shadows. We're gonna test out the system, and you've got the list of where you're supposed to check in when you come over. So
I will.
Well, thanks, guys, for the opportunity. Hopefully I didn't screw things up too bad for you.
Yeah, it's my bad, but...
I think it went well. I think we learned some good stuff. Or I may have learned some good stuff.
I got good comments on the YouTube.
Yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, we did. Yeah. We did.
All right.
Right until I dropped the stream.
Then they stopped commenting entirely.
Yeah, they 100% completely. I got to figure out how to recover that. But it does say it's restreaming, so I don't know where it's streaming.
It is not restreaming. There's nothing live going on.
It does. It says for 35 minutes it's been streaming. Let's see. It says.
No, it says streamed 33 minutes ago.
Well, yeah. Here, if I share this screen, I don't know. We're going to get hollow mirrors. Can you see this?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, hollow mirrors. It shows stream 36 minutes. Let's see. If I go to output and I want to stop, I can stop. It says I can stop the YouTube, but I can't. I can start the Facebook. So it did something. It's doing something. And you know what? Luckily for all of this, I've been recording for 2 hours and 6 minutes and 30 seconds. So that's what that I'll repost it tomorrow. Or maybe I'll start it after tonight.
Well, Marshall, now you've seen the secret sauce of what happens behind the curtain. Now I gotta get David to a couple more repeater sites so he can actually see how we Woo-hoo. Plug all this our stuff together.
Yep.
He's been to one of them.
We got the special bug tonight. It's almost ham radio now. All right, I'm gonna hit the stop.